Wait for people to come on. Hi there.
Okay. Hopefully we've got sound now. And hopefully we're back in business and we're working. So let me just begin this beautiful time of worship and praise by saying, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So Dana, can you tell us, do we have sound now? Hopefully we do. I got a thumbs up from somebody.
Yeah.
And so.
Better. Okay.
Better. Thank you.
Good. Yeah. Well, yeah. We just never know.
What happened there, no. But.
We have microphones and they have a couple of different
connections.
So who knows?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I'm glad we're back. Sorry about that.
So good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to the Robert Schiller Ministries, a church with no walls. And we're really, really excited to be able to be with you on this beautiful Sunday morning, to be able to praise God and to just be able to come together and pray for our nation and pray for the world.
Our nation.
And anyway, so that's why we're here today.
That is why we're here. And, you know, we've, today is kind of bittersweet. This isn't our last Sunday meeting in the parking lot here, which is now, we're turned around again. So this is the inside courtyard of the office complex we've been holding drive-in services in for now. This is our 11th week.
I know. Yeah,
11 weeks.
I thought I was going to be here for two or three weeks.
2 or 3 weeks, and here we are 11 weeks later. And last week on a Tuesday night, so last Sunday, we invited people to come over to our house for a little meeting. We had almost 20 people there just discussing, you know, what do we do? I mean, we set this up temporarily, this drive-in church. So should we stop now? Do you want to go back to your regular churches? Which, by the way, here in California, it's hit or miss because some of the churches are open with strict rules in place. Other churches have not opened yet at all because they can't figure out how to navigate these strict rules, and we won't go into all those rules. You can Google them, rules for churches to open in California.
Well, the large churches are really, really hamstrung because they're only allowed a maximum of 100 people. And if you're a large church with thousands of members, you have to have a service every 5-10 minutes in order to accommodate everybody.
Yeah, and we're not one of those, so that's saying it. But we're just glad to be here with you. Yeah, so a couple more things about our meeting. What we said to people that came, we said, if you want us to go, well, first of all, they said they told us with almost unanimity. Unanimously. they voted, if you will, to keep the drive-in going. People decided they like the drive-in. They like, one lady said she likes to come with her pajama bottoms on some Sundays. Another lady said, I just like to just sit there and worship God and roll down my windows and see the birds in the tree flying by. In fact, one gal said she sees a dove fly by between us and her car almost every Sunday morning. And when you did communion 2 weeks ago, that she said right as we were taking communion, this beautiful dove, and we have morning doves here in California, in Southern California. So she said, whoop, there's a bug. Speaking of bugs.
A little fly.
But it's just, there's been some beautiful things happen here, you know, and people bring their pets and people bring their coffee. And I guess it's just, there's a comfort in knowing you're in your own car. And then some people either have injuries or they don't get around as well as they used to. So just driving right up and parking right in front of where we speak, where Robert delivers a message is nice. And then at the very heart of it is being able to sing and worship God, because Sunday morning is a worship service. That's what we're supposed to do. Church is all week long and the way we live our lives. And Sunday morning is the coming together of God's people to celebrate. You taught me that years ago, Robert.
Exactly.
And to be able to celebrate and look in the cars next to you, in front of you, behind you, and to see people worshiping God together, to connect heart to heart that way. Eyeball to eyeball, emotionally. And without, you know, some people are now starting to get out of their cars at the end of the service and all. And you know, we've been with our family a lot. Anyway, it's just been beautiful. So we're continuing and we need your prayers. We're looking for a new location here in basically Southern Orange County. And we've been in a parking lot, but we need a new parking lot.
Yep, we're going to have to find another location. So we'll do that. But this is a time for us to be able to come together no matter where you are in the world. For we have people literally on every continent who have come and worshiped with us. Mm-hmm. And it's not uncommon for us to have several continents every Sunday morning. And so I know we have people from Africa, from Europe. We have people from the United States.
Mexico.
Central Woo-hoo. America, South America.
Our neighbor, Canada.
Yeah, North America. Actually, most of the people are from North America since this is the United States and we're broadcasting from the United States. But anyway, it's a beautiful time for us to be able to come together to worship God, to experience His presence in our lives, to get some spiritual encouragement, enlightenment, and some motivation because the positive words of the good news of Jesus is within the words of our Bible, and we talk about those every Sunday, and the reading that Donna's going to have for us in a little bit will be another, I believe, an inspiring word. So you notice the title of this one is "I Will Not Be Afraid." Mm-hmm. That's a quote. That's an actual quote from the book of Hebrews, the letter that Paul wrote to the church in Jerusalem. And so those words are words I want you to hear and to recite, and we're going to be going over that when I talk about my message. But again, it's words of inspiration, of hope, of joy, of peace, of strength, of encouragement, and that's what we're all about.
We are, and you know, I think with that being said, I think we need to address, you know, the horrible things that have happened in the United States in the last week since we've been on together, and those are, you know, some of these peaceful protests, if you will, are part of our right as human beings. And, you know, obviously there's all kinds of injustice happen. We're talking now about the killing of Mr. Floyd recently, which was the wrong thing. It was horrible, terrible. But the backlash of that, the outpouring of love is a good thing. But the outpouring and the deliberate violence and burning down of buildings and just civil unrest that's happened because of this, it's gone way too far. And, you know, I know it's overstated, it's overused, but you think about, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. and the movement he started with the civil rights movement and the peaceful protests the marches and things that went on. And, you know, you can look at great leaders around the world and the way they handle it. And you know, social change is something that happens. It's something that's necessary. We don't agree with injustice, but it just, you know, we have to be careful of how we demonstrate our emotions. And you know, we have a choice every day as human beings. We can't choose the way things happen to us always. We can't choose the way people treat us, the horrible things they say or do to us. But we always have a choice on how we react to that. And you know, that comes from the great late Dr. Viktor Frankl, of course, from the Holocaust, and when he was in the prison camps, and he just said, you know, you can take away everything from me, but you can never take away how I will react to what you do to me. And we just have to really prayerfully, as Christians, just make an effort to show love during this time, to show love and patience and endurance. And anyway,
you know, I think it's time for us to pray. We haven't had a prayer yet, and that because I want to pray for peace in our nation.
Yes.
I want to pray for peace in our souls of those who are troubled. And I want to pray for courage for those of you who are still frightened. And so let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray right now for every single voice who hears this message, for every single ear who hears this message. And so, oh God, as we come together as your people called in your name, we come before you now in prayer. We humble our hearts, our souls, our minds, and we realize that you are God. And we are your people. And so is our God. You will guide, you will direct. It will be your way. You are in control. Everything that's happening is for you are going to turn into good.
Yes.
We do not understand it. We don't comprehend it. But we know that what happens is going to be for our good. And so we thank you, Lord, for the opportunities we have right now to be able to come and to worship you. It is virtual, but it is real. It is, we are separated, but we are together. We are in different continents, but we are one. And so we are brought together by the blood of Jesus, who forgives our sins, who raises us up to be victors through you. And so we thank you, Lord, that we have nothing to fear because we are being led by you. You are in control. You will make things right. And so we thank you, Lord, and we praise your name always and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So I don't think I've given the opening sentence yet, meaning this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Yes.
And so we did a prayer, we did the opening sentence. You know, this is a church service. So one of the things we do when we have a church service is we pray, we read scriptures. And Donna has a very interesting scripture for us today that is going to be the basis of my message this morning. And so, Donna, would you read that for us?
Absolutely. Today, Robert has chosen a couple of verses from Hebrews, and Hebrews 12 and 13 selected verses. So listen to these words. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful, and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers. For by doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without even knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with whatever you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can human beings do to me? Let's pray. Lord, thank you that because you cover us with your shield, you cover our hearts, our minds, and our souls every single day, Lord, as long as we remember to call out to you. We thank you that you are our shield, that nothing can harm us because you are here with us, protecting us. Help each and every person that's listening today concentrate on this fact that you, Lord, are still in charge. When things are uncertain, when we feel anxious or worried or fearful, Lord, you are there. Help us to remember that. Help us to remember to call out to you, to ask for your help, Lord, because you want to help us. We love you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
And part of being a church is collecting an offering, because an offering is where we give God an example of our faith in him. And we show our faith in God by actually putting him first, as in front of our money, in front of our wallets, in front of our checkbooks. And so what we do is we make a pledge to God and we fulfill those pledges. And the pledge can be of financial means and sometimes of service means. There's different ways. But what we do in worship is we actually give our tithes and our offerings. A tithe is 10% of our income. And for those of you who say, that's absolutely, I can't possibly do that, then I say, okay, what is your measure of faith? Is it a dollar a week, $2, $5, $10, $100? It doesn't matter what that is, just that it is something. And God uses the faith you have today to bless you. And as you are blessed, you will discover that it is impossible to outgive God. And as a result of that, you will reach whatever it is that God has in store for you to bless you in ways you can't even possibly imagine. So this is an opportunity for you to give. And there's several ways to give. One way that you can give is to Venmo us. We actually take Venmo. It's Robert Schuller Ministries. If you do Robert Schuller, or maybe go to somebody else, so do make sure it says Robert Schuller Ministries, and you can Venmo us, And then the other way you can do it is you can click the notes section on the side of your Facebook page. And you want to explain how you do that?
The notes?
Yeah.
That's easy. Yes. So if you're looking at your Facebook page, there's a whole column of things to the left. And by the way, we've tried several times to get a donate button, but for some reason, even sending in our 501c3 and all the
We've done all the paperwork.
We've done everything three times. Anyway, Facebook doesn't want to allow that. So that's okay. Figured a way around it. So go to notes on the left. Just click on it and you'll see it's easy. And then it'll lead you to our online giving platform. Or you can email, you can mail it, a snail mail to 26 Canyon Island. Those are two words, Canyon Island, Newport Beach, California, 92660. Again, that's 26 Canyon Island. And it's, Canyon Island, Newport Beach. And make that to Robert Schuller Ministries. That's our home and our office as well. So thank you.
So, yeah, this is, again, it's an opportunity for us to express our faith in God. And even if it's a dollar, it's something. And it's from there that God can work, because God wants to know that you're involved with Him, that you have a little faith in Him, and with that He'll start to bless you. So it's a beautiful way for us to give.
It is.
The Bible says, "Give with what measure you give, it shall be given back to you." And so, pressed down, shaking together, running over. I could keep quoting, but anyway, that's what that's all about.
You ready to give your message?
I am. Oh. Give me the Bible.
There you are.
Because this is a this is a really beautiful text that we have today that I want to work with. Sounds good. God bless you, Donna. He is blessing us. And this is just a really cool, great time for us to be able to come together and to talk and to discover things about the Bible and the way things work and the way God works. And so today is actually the second Sunday of Pentecost. If you look at the church calendar, you'll find that it actually starts before January 1st. It starts four Sundays before Christmas. That's where the church calendar begins, meaning the church calendar begins with the four Sundays of Advent. Then you have Christmas Day. Then you have the Sundays of Christmas. And then comes Easter. And half of the Sundays begin on Pentecost Sunday, and it's the calendar and the season of Pentecost, which goes from now, actually started last week, and continues all the way to the first Sunday of Advent. That's the church calendar. Now, so what we do, obviously, during Advent is we talk about things, preparing our hearts for the coming of the baby Jesus. And then after that, we go and we prepare our hearts for Easter, and then the coming of the Holy Spirit. And then we spend half of the year talking about Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit comes and touches our hearts and gives us a flame, a fire, because on Pentecost Sunday, their flames of fire touched the apostles, and they were given a gift to be able to speak a language that could be understood by all the people in Jerusalem. Now, here we see it continuing in Hebrews as St. Paul, who's writing to the church in Jerusalem. There is a Jewish Hebrew church in Jerusalem, and it is to them that he writes, and it's considered one of the most beautiful pieces of scripture in the Bible, because there is so much in here, and I think I could give a sermon on almost every sentence in this specific book of Hebrews. But in the interest of time, I've got to say that, first of all, it says that in, Donna read for us, in verse 29 of the 12th chapter, God is a consuming fire. And by that fire, that consuming fire, isn't a fire of destruction. Because the Holy Spirit came and it like flames, it said, and touched the apostles and gave them a gift. God's consuming fire is not destruction, but creation. God is not a God of destruction, but a God of creation. We see that from the very beginning. In the beginning, God created, and He created everything there is, and everything that there ever has been, and everything there ever will be, is a result of the hand of God. God is a God of creation. And this, it says again, God is a consuming fire. This consuming fire is a fire of construction, not destruction. It is a God of creation, not a God of damnation. And so here we have this word from St. Paul that he gives to the church in Jerusalem, Hebrews. The Hebrews knew the Old Testament. Well, his other letters, which are basically to Greek communities like Philippians and Colossians and Corinthians, these are all areas of Greece, and they were Roman, Greco-Roman communities. And as a result of that, they didn't understand the history of the Bible and the Old Testament. And so he couldn't, to communicate with them, he couldn't talk about things that took place in the Old Testament and expect them to understand anything. However, in Hebrews, he can talk with them and he can know they will understand what he is saying. And so Hebrews is a unique Bible, is a unique book in the Bible in that it talks to who we are today, understanding the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And so he refers to God as a consuming fire, a fire that consumes our hearts and our souls and our minds, that brings us into his presence. And here's what I want to focus on today, and this is what I want you to hear, and this is what I want to take you to take with you today. In verse 5 of the 13th chapter of Hebrews, he says, "Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, 'Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you.'" And guess what? St. Paul is quoting Moses, who is sharing this with Joshua. We find that in Deuteronomy. At the very end of Deuteronomy, one of the books in the Old Testament, Moses is about to die. He's 120 years old. And he says, "My ministry is over." And he's passing the baton now to Joshua. And he's encouraging Joshua, who is going to enter the promised land, which Moses is not allowed to enter because he had his chances and he didn't take him when he had his chances. And so God is saying it's time for Joshua, who's been there before, to take over and to lead the people into the promised land. And Moses says to Joshua, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you, says the Lord of hosts. Be strong and very courageous." Be strong and very courageous. He says it two or three times as he is about to enter this promised land that God has promised to the Israelites and that they have been working towards and moving towards for 40 years. For 40 years, they spent time in the wilderness, and now it is getting time for them to enter the promised land. And so it is with us. God is a consuming fire. He consumes our souls, our minds. He consumes us, and like a hen who brings her chicks around her, God, and consumes her chicks, so God consumes us. He brings us around. And as such, he says, "I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you." What an amazing promise he gives to us as we are here today, living and breathing as a gift from God, because every single moment we have is a gift from God. We do not deserve it. There's nothing we can do to earn it. It is absolutely nothing more than a gift from God, every single moment we have. And so we must give thanks and praise to God for this very moment. And so we know that he will never leave us and never forsake us. And you think to yourself, how can that be? Because you're thinking, and it's a natural understanding for us to think in human terms. But what I want you to understand is that we are not human beings. You heard me right. We are not human beings with spiritual experiences. We're not human beings. We are spiritual beings on a human journey. I hope you hear what I'm saying. As spiritual beings, we have nothing to fear. Who are you? You are not your flesh and blood. You are the Son of the living God. You are the the princes and princesses of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are God's children. And as God's children, we can hold on to the promises of God. And he says very clearly, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. I don't know about you, but that gives me tremendous confidence and assurance. And then he goes on to say, so we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. Did you hear me? The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. This is a profession that I want you to say out loud wherever you are right now. If you're sitting there with your family members, turn to each other right now and say these words, the Lord is my helper. Turn to the person next to you, behind you, around you. If you're alone, you can say it as loud as you want. The Lord is my helper. It is a confession that we make. It is a proclamation. It is a declaration. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. And you think to yourself, wow, I can say that all I want, but I'm still afraid. Well, let me tell you what the difference is between being afraid and being courageous. Fear is an emotion. And we all have the emotions of fear. But I'm not afraid because I break through that fear barrier and do what God has called me to do. I don't live in fear. I live in the promises of God. And my actions are not based upon my feelings, but based upon the promises of God. So even though I have feelings of fear to walk out into whatever it is that God has given to me, I do it anyway. I break through the emotions and my actions follow course and follow what God has called me to do. That's courage. That's being unafraid. I will not be afraid. I will not allow my emotions to control my actions. Because if I allowed my emotions to control my actions, I would be locked up in prison. There are times I've wanted to strangle people. There are times I've wanted to do things that are completely immoral and unethical. And those are feelings that come and go. But we don't live and base our lives on our feelings, like fear, like anger, but we base them on the promises of God, on love. So our actions are ones of love and not of fear. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Bible says. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can human beings do to me? And some of you immediately are saying, oh, they can do plenty. They can shoot me, they can stab me, they can torture me, they can do whatever they want to me. But the fact is, they're not doing it to you. They're doing it to your physical body. But your physical body isn't you. Because again, you are not a human being with spiritual experiences. You are a spiritual being on a human journey. And as we continue to move on this journey, as we continue to take the steps that God has challenged and given us to take, we realize that we'll live a life based upon love and conviction and hope and goodness, and we do not allow fear to consume us. That's why when all the other churches in Orange County and across the nation closed down, I said, I'm not going to close down. I'm going to open. I'm going to find a way to do it. And we started holding drive-in services here. It was the last Sunday of March, and there wasn't another place in Orange County where people could go to worship God. And we had church. And we've been doing that ever since. Now today, some of the churches are starting to open. Next week, many more churches are going to open. But they're hamstrung. Their hands are tied in California. They're not allowed to do all kinds of things like sing. People have to wear masks. And they're being directed by fear. Fear that is not justified with the science that we have today and what we know. And so because of this, and because of the fact that people love worshiping in their cars, and there's nowhere else in Orange County where people can go and worship in their cars, I've decided that we're going to continue to hold services for those who want to, and we're going to see where it goes from there. I had no intention whatsoever of starting a church when we started holding services here. I was just going to do it for 2 or 3 weeks. And now this is week number 11. Next week will be week number 12. And people have come together and bonded. And so we are in effect starting a drive-in church somewhere. I don't know where. But God will lead. So I am not afraid. What did he say? Never will I leave you. I believe that. Never will I forsake you. I believe that with all of my heart. And as a result of that, I can confess, and I pray that you are confessing with me, the Lord is my helper. Say it out loud wherever you are right now. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. You have nothing to fear because the Lord is your helper. There is no human that can touch you. You know this question, what can human beings do to me? It's a rhetorical question. And the rhetorical question has the resounding answer, absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. Because you are a child of the King of Kings, of the Lord of Lords. You are a child of God, called by him, brought to his being. He has consumed you with his fire. The fire which is energy and power. Fire which has the ability to transform things like we cannot even begin to imagine. Fire which has the ability to make you stronger than you ever possibly imagined. It tempers steel. And that's who you are. You are being tempered by God to become stronger than you could ever possibly imagine. Here we are. What can humans do to us? Absolutely nothing, because we are saved by the grace of Jesus. We profess his love for us. And when we come to be with God forever in paradise, there will be Jesus with open arms embracing us and bringing us to his fold. I believe that with every fiber of my being. I hold to that. I worship that because I worship God. God who has revealed himself over and over again. We can look throughout history how God fed the Israelites for 40 years in the wilderness. Talk about miracles. How else can millions of people survive in a land of nothing? God fed them every single day. Nothing else makes any sense. It was a miracle, beyond miracles. And just as he fed them, he'll feed us, he'll care for us. And that doesn't mean we're going to live forever. In fact, it means just the opposite. It means that someday we will stop breathing. I don't know how, I don't know when it's going to be, for me or for you, or no one else does. If a doctor tells you you have only a few months to live because you have this, that, or the other thing, that's just his best guess. It doesn't mean anything. I could tell you this. I could spend an hour telling you stories of people who are told that they have cancer, get ready to prepare and to die. And that was 20, 30 years ago. It happens all the time. Nobody but God knows. And every single day we have is a gift from God. Today is the day we can come and we can declare from the mountaintops that Jesus Christ died for our sins, that he cleanses us, that he loves us, that he cares about us, that we have today because of that gift from Him. So, we make our profession of faith. We declare, as St. Paul told us to, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have been called by you, created by you, given breath by you. And so we thank you today, oh Lord, for today, for this moment. We thank you that you have given us the freedom to be who you've called us to be. Our freedom is not given by human hands, but by our faith in Jesus. We can be in chains, and we can be free. We can be imprisoned and still be free, because our freedom is not a physical freedom, but a spiritual freedom to be able to worship you with our hearts and our minds, and no one can ever take that away from us. And so we thank you, Lord. We praise your name, and we give you glory and honor forever and always. We love you, Lord. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord grant you his peace. In your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears, until you come to stand before Jesus in that day in which there is no sunset and no dawning. Amen. God bless you, everybody. Have a great day, and we'll be here again next week. Bye-bye.